to start by asking you to tell our viewers a little bit about yourself. You have a very interesting background.
Well, I guess I can start like you. I was born in Cuba and I came over to the United States as a little girl. I was 5 when we arrived in New York. And my family background is a little unusual because I'm Cuban Jewish. Maybe not so unusual in Miami where we have a lot of Cubans, but I guess the interesting part is that both my parents were born in Cuba, but my mother's family was Polish, Russian, and then my father's family was Turkish of Sephardic ancestry. So these two different Jewish cultures merged in the marriage of my parents. And so I grew up knowing about these very different Jewish traditions, but also being very aware of being Cuban, growing up speaking Spanish and hearing the stories of Cuba. So all of that, you know, really made me the person that I am. And eventually I became an anthropologist because I was so interested in different cultures and understanding diversity and how do you hold on to one culture and acquire another culture. So those kinds of questions really interested me, and it led to a lot of travel for a large part of my life. I was living for years in Spain and then in Mexico, and then I started traveling back and forth to Cuba. And but I also always loved to write, and eventually also started writing fiction and poetry and even some memoir as well.
So when did you start writing?
So I would say I started writing probably when I was about 10 or 11. There's a difference between writing and publishing. So I was writing in the sense that I was keeping journals. And then in high school, I had a wonderful Cuban teacher. She was just the greatest. And she encouraged me to write poetry in Spanish. So in high school, I was trying to write some poems in Spanish. So I was always interested in writing. And I loved to read and just really put writers on a pedestal. I thought writing was like the most amazing thing anybody could do. So I was always, you know, trying to write. Publishing is a different thing, but I kept a lot of diaries and journals. I had one of those little diaries, a little red diary with a key. It would open and close with a little key. If you remember that kind of diary, like back, you know, when I was 10, 11 years old. Which I still have. So writing was always a passion of mine, like keeping notes about things, wanting to hold on to memories of things that had happened, wanting to keep, you know, a diary of my day-to-day life, of what I was observing. And all of that, again, was really good for me as an anthropologist, where you keep field notes and things like that. So writing was always very, very important. And then publishing kind of came afterwards, where, okay, is this good enough to share with the rest of the world, or is this just writing I'm doing for myself? And then that gradually happened. First, I wrote books about my travels to Spain and to Mexico and to Cuba, and then eventually had the courage to start writing some poetry that I felt I could publish, and then fiction as well.
But Letters from Cuba is not your first novel.
It's my second novel. It's my second novel. So my first is Lucky Broken Girl. And that one came out just 4 years ago. And it was my first published novel. And it was a very exciting book to write. I had no idea that I was writing a novel for young people. I just started writing it in the voice of a 10-year-old girl. A girl who was me in a way, because it's the story of a Cuban girl who's just arrived in New York, and shortly after she and her family get settled in, they're in a terrible car accident, and Ruthie, the character in Lucky Broken Girl, ends up in a body cast and can't move for a year and has to be in bed, and her mom has to take care of her. And that's based on my story, because that actually happened to me. And it was one of those turning points, you know, that we all have in our lives. Like that was a huge turning point for me. I was a very active girl. I don't even really remember that, but my brother tells me that I was just a super active girl, and I played a lot of hopscotch on the streets of New York, on the pavements of New York. And then I was in this terrible body cast for a year and couldn't move. So it was a terrible, terrible, terrible experience. But at the same time, it is called Lucky Broken Girl because some lucky things happened out of that tragedy. One of the most important ones is that my school, my public school, sent a tutor to our house. And so she was teaching me at my bedside and brought me lots and lots of books. And since I couldn't do much else, that was all I did for about a year, is just read a lot of books. So I became very smart that year and became very interested in books, and also became a very contemplative kind of kid. And I think that's, you asked before about my writing, and I think that was the moment when I realized that I was a reader and that I wanted to be a writer. It was really that year in bed. So that was the first novel, and it was based on my story, and it involved going back to the period of the 1960s when the story takes place, 1966. And the story, the song, "These Boots Are Made for Walking," was very popular at that moment. And so it's that era, that 60s era, and the book is set at that time. And then the new book, "Letters from Cuba," this one is inspired by my grandmother, my maternal grandmother, and I set it in the late 1930s on the eve of the war. And I wanted to honor her because she was the first of all the children in her family to go to Cuba, meet up with her father and my great grandfather, and help to bring the whole family over. So with "Letters from Cuba," I went further back in history into the 20s and 30s and looked at that period of time. And it was really a fun and beautiful novel to write.
Yeah, I loved it. You mentioned in the part of the book, the author's note, that different stories meshed in writing your book. The Jewish Cuban immigrant story and the Afro-Cuban post-slavery story. So what kind of research did you have to do to be able to write the book?
Yeah, thanks for that question. I did a lot of research. There was a lot I didn't know. So I had that inspiration of my grandmother's story, but I really didn't know what was it like day to day to be a Polish Jewish girl arriving in a tropical island like Cuba. How do you learn Spanish? What does it feel like to taste a pineapple for the first time, which she wouldn't have had in Poland, right? And what does it feel like to be in that tropical air, that's kissed by the sea, that salty, air of Cuba or of Miami for that matter, and to arrive in Cuba with a woolen dress, and your woolen dress would feel terrible to be wearing in Cuba. So how does she finally get a nice light dress that can tolerate that hot climate? So I started thinking about all these things I didn't know. So in part, I had to imagine, I had to put myself in the place of a girl, like my grandmother at that time. What was it like? What did she experience? What did she feel? What were those first, kind of sensorial, experiences, the smells, the sounds, the tastes, and all of that. So that's kind of sort of started with imagination. But then there was so much I didn't know about that period of the 30s, and what was life like in Cuba at the time, what was going on in Cuba. I found out, that Cubans are an extremely tolerant people, and so there were actually movements at the time, anti-racist movements, and movements against anti-Semitism that were led by, the great Cuban anthropologist Fernando Ortiz in the 30s. So there were all of these people that were, very supportive of Jews. But then there was also a Cuban Nazi party. Not many were members of it, but it existed. And so those were things I didn't know. I didn't know that the Nazis had sent agents to Cuba in the 30s to try to turn Cuban people against the Jewish immigrants that were trying to come to the island. So all of that was historical research, that I did. But I was also interested in understanding the immigrants and understanding immigrants in that period. And fortunately, historians have collected books of letters written by immigrants, because that was the way immigrants communicated with their families, back in the home countries.
And that's the style
And
of the book. So the
that's the
whole
style of the book.
letters,
All
Esther's
letters.
letters to her sister. So that was.
Yeah. And I was inspired by all those letters that I read in the history books, and they weren't necessarily all letters by Jewish immigrants. A lot of them were, but there were Irish immigrants and Polish immigrants, Italian immigrants, and so these are collections of letters. So it gave me a sense of like how important the letter format was at that time, before the internet, before telephones. This was how people communicated. And I even remembered my mother, my grandmother, my two grandmothers receiving letters from family, you know, back in the 60s and 70s, and like a letter was just such an important form of communication. So that was
the only form
at a distance, you know.
Yeah. By the letter, it was like all this excitement because you got to hear from your loved ones who were far away. So it was something to look forward to, like the one thing that people would look forward to.
Yeah, no, exactly. They were treasured. Those letters were treasured. So I thought about all that. And then I went to Cuba. And the, you know, the novel is set in the town of Agramonte. Agramonte is the small town
where
in the province of
Santos.
Yeah, it's set there. And that's actually where my grandmother and the family lived when they first arrived in Cuba. They were the only Jewish family living in the town of Agramonte. And I thought that was so fascinating. You know, here they are in this very different part of the world, a sugar growing town, as you said, where there had been enslaved Africans brought from West Africa, Yoruba people brought to work the sugar. So there was all of that presence of Afro-Cuban culture and religion in this part of Cuba. And I thought that was so fascinating. And that here was this Jewish family, you know, not realizing the horror that was about to come into Europe with the Holocaust. You know, they were just leaving because there was poverty and discrimination and anti-Semitism and, you know, and racial hatred and so on. So they knew things were getting worse, but they didn't know exactly how bad they would get. And then they find themselves in this very, very different place where, you know, here is another group of people who have suffered, the Jewish people have suffered in Europe, they've been treated as the other, and then they learn that, well, here's this whole other community of people, the Afro-Cubans, whose ancestors suffered in Cuba. So I wanted to connect those two stories, and that's why I went to Agramonte. And fortunately, there are a lot of local historians there, and they had old pictures of Agramonte from that era, and they told me a lot about the history of the town, and I learned about the sacred ceiba tree, where offerings are left for the spirits of enslaved Africans. And so all of those things were just so incredibly inspiring to me. And then also learning about the Chinese-Cuban presence as well, because there were a lot of Chinese workers who also worked in sugarcane in the 19th century, and then others who came later. And there were Chinese Cubans living in Agramonte. I found some historical documents about that as well. So all of those things kind of came together in the story, and that became the setting and the context for the story.
Well, I just wanted to touch upon another thing that I found. I mean, there's so many things we could talk about. We could talk about the book for hours because there's so much in there, so many themes and so much imagery, such richness. But, you know, I love poetry and I love Jose Martí. And I love that you intersperse some of his verses throughout the book. And one that I think you repeated a couple of times, which I think reflects one of the themes in the book, is, and I want to say it out loud in Spanish, and then I'll repeat it in English. It says, yo vengo de todas partes y a todas partes voy. I come from all places, and to all places I go. So these two verses like really capture the immigration story of not just Cubans, but all Americans, right? Because we all come from different places, and sometimes we end up in other places. So what other themes do you feel besides that one? And do you agree that's one of the themes you feel is important to mention? What are the themes you feel are important to mention?
Yeah, thank you. No, I also love Jose Martí, and I read and reread him all the time. And those particular lines are just so meaningful because Martí himself was an immigrant, you know, and he was an exile. He lived in New York for about 14 years, and he actually wrote those versos sencillos in New York, you know, in the Catskill Mountains, and he wrote them in Spanish, you know, being in New York, and that seems so amazing. So that kind of displacement, you know, being not at home, but always dreaming of home, holding on to your language, the way he held on to Spanish while living in New York. He was also a translator. So all of that seemed to really connect with the story of this Polish Jewish girl finding her way to Cuba. And one of the themes, I think, is, you know, how do you move on to a new place and still remember who you were, right? How do you hold on to the culture that you left behind, but also embrace the new culture that is so exciting? And this is what happens to Esther. She embraces this Afro-Cuban culture, this Chinese-Cuban culture, this, you know, Spanish-Cuban culture that she's immersed in Agramonte. She's embracing all of that, and it's embracing her too. But then her father, her papa, is worried and thinks that, oh my God, you're going to lose your Jewishness. You know, remember, we're Jewish, so don't get too involved with people who are different from you. And the novel tries to focus on that, on like how you can accept.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. How you can accept other cultures, and that doesn't mean you're going to lose your own, that there's a way to be hybrid, to be mixed, you know, to be in more than one place, exactly as Marti says it, and that all of us as humans have that possibility to adapt to new places, right? That we come from all places in that sense, and we can also go to all places, that as human beings, we can understand each other wherever we are. And I love that very idealistic way of thinking about identity.
Yeah, one of the other themes that really touched me, and I think anyone reading it would definitely be touched by it because of what we've gone through with COVID, of how important family is, of how we would do anything for family and to be with our family, because that's what makes us whole. And that was so beautiful. I have to tell you, I teared up a couple of times. I did. Especially when it came to that longing and, Esther and her dad did everything they could to bring the rest of the family to Cuba. Things that, you know, they shouldn't even have done. I'm thinking the figurines of the little Catholic saints and, selling them to be able to have money to be able to bring the family over. Things that you wouldn't normally do, but you do what you have to do, right, for your family. And so, yeah, it was endearing. It was touching. I loved how you described it and their feelings towards it. And that sense of, you know, we do what we have to do for family.
Mm-hmm. I think that's so powerful. I totally agree. I think the idea of the family, you know, among Cubans and other Latinos is so powerful. Among Jewish people, it's so powerful. And I did want to make a kind of, you know, statement, a symbolic statement about that in the novel, because I was thinking of young immigrants today. I was thinking of child immigrants and others who are separated, whose families are separated, or kids whose parents get, you know, deported. And what that must feel like, what those family separations must feel like to a young person or to a mother losing her child, and just how horrendous that would be. And I had all of those thoughts in mind and thinking about children in cages on the border and so on. And just, I was just so horrified by that. And as I was thinking about it, I said, wait a minute, but this happened in our own family. You know, my family was separated for a while until my grandmother, you know, helped to bring them all together. And it's just a completely different time and a completely different context, but it's the same thing. It's families trying to be together, trying to hold on to one another, and being separated by, you know, by terrible things that happen, you know, like war and poverty and discrimination and violence and so on.
And because of a pandemic.
or a pandemic. Let's add the pandemic, you know, into it. As well, exactly, that, you know, people who couldn't see their grandchildren for almost 2 years and so on, or you couldn't see an elder, or you couldn't go to an elder's funeral during the pandemic. So, I mean, just all of these really heart-wrenching separations that, as exactly as you said, that were caused by the pandemic. And so, so I think that's hopefully what we've all been through in the pandemic has opened our hearts to people who are struggling in these kinds of ways.
So any new books in your future?
Yes. So I have, this is not the book yet, but this is what it's going to look like. Tia Fortuna's New Home. And this is a picture book. And it's coming out January 25th, and we'll be presenting it at Books and Books on January 25th on the pub date and the back part. And I'll be in conversation with Richard Blanco about the book. And it's also coming out simultaneously in Spanish on Nuevo Hogar, the Tia Fortuna. So it's a story that takes place in Miami, actually. So I'm very excited about that. And this is a Sephardic story. So it's kind of a contrast to Letters from Cuba, which is a story about the Polish side of my family. This book is about the Turkish Sephardic Cuban.
So Nazi was the story of your dad's family, right? Or your mom's?
Mom's. The Letters from Cuba was my mom's family, and now this is my father's family, the Sephardic side. So looking at that and looking at, you know, a whole different heritage that comes from, you know, from the Jewish side that was originally Spanish in the 15th century and held on to the Spanish language as they immigrated out to places like Turkey, as my family did. So this one also, this new book, it's for a much younger audience, because it's a picture book, but it also has to do with immigration and moving on and the search for home, which is the topic also of Letters from Cuba, searching for home. And can you find a new home? What does it mean to have to give up one home for another home? So it carries that same theme, but for a different audience. It's kind of like a poem, because, you know, writing a picture book is a very different process from writing a novel, because you're trying to write something that's about under 1,000 words or even under 800 words. And how do you say much with that limited amount of word count? So it was really a challenge, but it was like writing a poem and trying to say everything I want to say, you know, in the most concise and lyrical way that I could.
Well, congratulations. I can't wait to read it and to read it to my grandson in both languages. So you'll be participating in the Miami Book Fair this weekend, right? Tell us about that. In case our viewers want to go see the discussion and see you or meet you in person.
That would be fantastic. I would love for people to come. That's on Saturday at 1 o'clock, and I'll be presenting Letters from Cuba. I'm sharing the stage with another Cuban-American writer, Susana Drissi. So we'll both be talking about our novels. We've both written historical fiction. So I imagine we'll be focusing on that, on history and Cuba, and all the different histories and cultures of Cuba and how we write about them in our novels. So would love it if people could come Saturday, 1 p.m. And I'm also featured on a panel that's being streamed as well, that I think is also going to start streaming on Saturday. And it's a panel about history and hardship and healing. And I'm in conversation with two other writers on that panel. So you can either, you know, listen in to the panel or come and see me in person, which would be great. This is actually my first in-person event since the pandemic.
Oh, wow. That's going to be exciting. Exciting. So thank you so much, Ruth, for being with us this morning. Thank you for your time. We wish you great success. I can see it. It's coming your way, not just with this book, obviously, but with the new one. So congratulations to you. And once again, thank you for being with us on South Florida PBS Facebook page.
Thank you, Jen. It's really been a pleasure and an honor. Thank you so much for all your wonderful questions and your support for my work. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in.